trained. So in Turkish pizza sektöründeyiz. We can start with the performance. And then I will speak briefly about the content of the book. And then Rob will speak about its design. And then we can have an open conversation. Yeah?
Why not? Okay. Hello everyone. Welcome to our small and short poetry event. This mic can go out of this heavy stative. Because two of us are constantly quarreling how to start anything. So I have one idea and a friend of mine from Skart has another idea, but then I will let him explain the context of poetry and then I will continue.
So I will explain. Since we started 33 years ago, he, among other things, he writes a poetry. So he was writing poetry for many years before that as a student and sending to the poetry festivals around Yugoslavia. And he was never accepted. Then, in 1991, he was accepted in the final, chosen in the final, called Into, with his poems. But he was, that year he wrote the poems and sent to that festival also under my name. And they both were chosen to go to the final for the poetry event. Then we came to an idea. I had no idea about poetry because I was not following that, not writing. So his suggestion was, let's make something different. And he was right. Poetry festivals, when we went there in Podgorica, at that time Tito del Montenegro, the poets, they come to the poetry festival and take their poems in their hands like this and read. They don't know by heart their poems. And you see how they have a stage fear. The paper is shaking like this while they read. And that was how they were performing. Around then, we made a little performance of every poem he wrote. So this equation is just to you to see how the process of developing presentation of the poem was going on. And now he will explain one poem and perform it.
Okay, but why don't you start? Because he's not prepared, but okay, I will do and he will prepare himself. Seda had one idea, what to read, but actually I will skip maybe from that because it will be part of the book. And then I will just do a couple of things and then Jole, and if you want more, you can say you want more poetry and then we can continue. So from time to time, actually, we are writing poetry as a tool for other different things. Like, for example, children choir or other choir, which we are collaborating with for already 20 years, or different street actions or poetry festivals, which we are organizing, or even graphic materials, which we are designing, which you can see here on the tables and around. All the times poetry is implemented as kind of extra something which has no need, kind of needless thing, which is important for us because language is the power, language is politic. And actually, in the meantime, maybe two of you can distribute our stickers. This is one of examples of, let's say, kind of poetry gesture or, of course, resistance tool, how to use language as a tool of resistance. Okay, so, but it's another story. Let's start with something very simple, very short. We are collaborating with the school of with one orphanage in east of Serbia, and most of the kids in that place they have kako se kaže žole vaške You have small bugs in a hair. How do you call it? Fleas. Fleas. Hmm? Do you know this small? How do you call it? Okay.
In Turkish. We know the Turkish.
So most of the kids have these little things in the hair, and actually most of us we had this when we've been kids. Did you have that fleece? Who had that? I Zsola, you never. Okay. So okay, half. So this is one very simple poem. It will be in Serbo-Croatian language, just for you to hear the Serbo-Croatian kind of rhythm of the language and how it's actually done for the purpose of singing with the choir. I also need to read, but doesn't matter. So title is Vaša Vaš. In Serbo-Croatian is Vaš, Vaška, Vaška. Vaša Vaš. Koto, 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 koto ima vaške, i vaške i naške, svačije obaške, i ženske i maške, a to je te preške. Koto, 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 koto ima vaške, ide u natraške, noću i današke, peške i privaške, a to je te preške. Koto, 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 koto ima vaške, ne znamo ne znaške, ko se prvi počeše, vaške na njih kočeše, ko se prvi počeše, vaške na njih kočeše, ko se prvi počeše, vaške na njih kočeše, ko se prvi počeše, vaške na njih skočeše. Thank you. Now something actually which Seda asked for. In 1993, so we are jumping, but it will be messy presentation, why not? In 1993 we started to distribute street cardboards with some poems. Maybe some are here, doesn't matter. Okay. So these are, in the time it was war in Yugoslavia and Serbia. So each week we started to write poems about situation in the war with different subjects, some personal things, some political things, etc., etc. So for example, sadness of potential travelers. Travelers do not travel. Something takes them away and brings them back. Changing places is not traveling. Travelers travel sadly. So it was 1992. Or this one, sadness of potential genealogy. It's actually really applicable also for the context of Turkey. Belonging to mommy and daddy like you. After all, there are photographs. It's sad if they think belonging to history and geography. 1993, Belgrade. And now I will jump to another totally different thing. And then, Joel, are you ready? Okay. We spoke what will be the next step of our collaboration, because we are working for already 33 years, try to imagine. 33 years of unmarried couple. And then Zsola told me, let's continue taking care of small stories, small things. Let's keep it small. And then this is something about one guy who lived in one island in Croatia called Vis. And this guy was a local electrician worker. So he was climbing on this, I don't know what is in English.
Poles.
Poles. Okay. On these columns, you know, like really high ones, and he was repairing these wires which go endlessly. So he was always somewhere up, and he was singing when he was doing that. And it's a small island, and whenever you are reaching this island by boat, you hear somebody singing. You don't see him, but he is up there repairing wires and singing. Really beautiful small scene. And actually, he died recently. And then we made one simple poem for him and for his braveness and for this unnecessary extra thing. He was doing his job and he was singing like a bird, like a star. Okay, so this is a song for him. And actually, this song was composed, is composed by a friend of ours, trying to make it in a way like Dalmatian singing groups are doing. So it sounds a little bit traditional, but it's not. Okay. Title is One. Bio jednom jedan na vrhu bandere, na otoku Visu, a ostali di su, a ostali di su. Hrabrio je ptice, hrabrio je ljude, što odustali su, a ostali di su, a ostali di su. Pevao je glasno i znao sve reči, što gromovi nisu, a ostali di su, a ostali di su. And this is the last. Srce mu je zvonik na vrhu bandere, na otoku Visu, a ostali di su, a ostali di su, a ostali di su, where they are, the others, where they are. He disappeared, and where are the others? A ostali di su, a ostali di su.
This is very unusual for me, and I still can't remember how I accept it, because if I hate something, I hate the public opinions like this. But anyway, I was young, and so this is the one poem which I will show. It looks like this. That's a protest poem. It's actually letter A. Long letter A goes like, I'll now translate, and after that show you how I was performing that. Like A, and a thousand times like this, and you are so far away that I cannot reach you with my A. And I was performing that like this in the festival. So first I was trying to... because we pronounce letter A as A. That's a long, long A. Another song, poem, actually, which was not translated, not performed, interpretation, is called Springtime. The translation literally goes like that. Springtime, to read English, my heart, it's called Springtime, always after winter, never after summer, never after springtime. Never springtime, summer, springtime. Never springtime, springtime, springtime. That was the translation.
Now I'll perform if you like. So I have a wooden stick with three leaves. Springtime. Always after winter. Never after summer. Never after springtime. Springtime after springtime, never. Springtime, springtime, springtime. I was making that in front of the audience because they were very usual to do that, very classical stuff, like people reading. For them, there was pretty much like, strange. And what was
even more strange is that they like it a lot. So after that next year, eight of us entered the final. All of us with protest poems, which was one third of the total finalists. And we all made spectacle. And I got the third prize with the award and became our guest on the radio, TV, and so on. So it was sort of the punk subversion of the poetry festivals in a desperate attempt to make poetry more acceptable or more interesting for the audience. So you and you. Thank you.
Would you like to maybe come close to the pool, or are you comfortable there? I mean, we are a small group, so it would be nice to come close if you feel comfortable. The book is also here. Maybe we can circulate if you like. So, brief story, where and how I met Škart. So they're both from Belgrade, and in 2019 I was in Belgrade for 3 months. I was joining the curriculum program there, so I was living there for a couple of months in the city. And in this program we do lots of studio visits. You know, we have this kind of speed datings with artists. You have look at portfolios, and in my case it's really a rare opportunity that this kind of occasions turn into friendships or collaborations. But Proto, that time, invited us, all these curators in the group, to his house, this beautiful house with the garden in Belgrade. And also he invited some of their collaborators that they've been working together like maybe over 20 years. For example, Lenka. So she, and she and I think she got met in the early 2000s in this women embroidery groups. Lenka was one of the participants who used this kind of traditional medium to share her voice in a very patriarchal society. And she will do these embroidery pieces and also perform them like Prota and Jolie did not go on stage. Or there was also Philip. And Philip was singing the songs that Škart wrote in workshops with the elderly people. Usually their verses or like small poems then becomes songs. And then there was also Mirko, who was performing his poems about the struggles of the mentally ill people. For me, that event was very emotional, but also it kind of demonstrated as a kind of different way of doing things with art. So for me, it was a kind of sign that how it can be a tool to bring small changes and small like gestures in other people's life. And I was very touched by this. And also from a curatorial point of view, I was thinking, how could I make such an invisible practice, actually? How can I share this, you know? And I also asked this question to Prota, but how do you imagine sharing this work with others and how we can open your work to the wider audience? And he said something like, but no one will be interested anyways, you know, something like this. And I know that it is important, especially for such kind of marginalized practice that they didn't make their way to Western art history as we know it. So for me, it was also very important to work with this kind of marginalized practices. This is one photo from the archive. And it's from Prota's mom's house in Zlenjanin, in a small city in Serbia. So the okay, I'll show you one more photo so you also see how the archive looks like and what we go through. So for me, that was the starting question. So how to document, archive, and share social practice? And can a book produce a narrative or plural narratives of shared invisible social practice? And during that time I met Shikard, by chance, I was also reading Zdenka Badovinac. She's a Slovenian art historian, writer, and curator. And she talks about these parallel histories of artistic practices that is, again, as I said, that they didn't make their way to Western art history. So they create this kind of parallel and interrupted histories. I will just read this quote because this is more or less my position and my motivation to work in this book. Lacking a suitable collective history or sympathetic state institutions, many artists were forced to self-historize to search out their own places in historical or interpretive context. They had to become their own art historians and archivists. Such self-historization includes the collecting and archiving of documents, whether of one's own art actions or of broader movements, thereby recording art forms and social fields otherwise marginalized by local politics and invisible in the context of international art. I think more or less maybe Turkey can be also considered in this as a group of interrupted histories where there is not much well-functioning art institutions or archival practices. This job is on the artist, and I think I consider it as a part of my curatorial responsibility to work with such practices and give a visibility. So I came back to Hamburg after Belgrade, and this question stayed with me. So how I can share it with a broader audience? And as a creator, the first thing that came to my mind was making an exhibition, of course. I also love exhibitions, but then I think I wanted to do something more selfish because I wanted to do something more permanent and mobile and intimate. And this was how the idea of a book came. And it's called Building Human Relations Through Art, a motto of Shikard. This is the beautiful back cover. So the book is actually made through long conversations between me and Shikard. It is a pandemic book, so as opposed to our plans that, you know, I was supposed to go to Serbia, spend time with Shikard, go through the archives and materials. And that was during the hardcore isolation period, so I couldn't travel. And instead, we had to go through this 5 o'clock tea time Skype conversations for a year and a half. So you can imagine I had hours and hours of hours conversation with Shikard. And in the book, they are edited in three parts. So part one is 90s, part two is 2000, 2010, and part three is from 2010 till today. And this is kind of not a lazy editorial decision, actually, to go through this chronological approach. Shkret's practice is pretty much shaped by the social political upheaval in Serbia and Yugoslavia. As you might know, between 90 to 2000, there was a 10 years of war, which also really shaped Shkret's practice. So we, in these decades, we also see the changes. In the first part, mainly we see printed materials and printed artworks. And I also brought so many originals from Shkret archive here. If you like, you can just come by and have a look. Here, for example, we have posters with their rather like abstract Dalit language, and Shkret will just go in the street and put the posters in the street. Or it's also good to add, actually, you were always working as a graphic designer, and you are still working as a graphic designer, and that's how they actually earn their life. So there's lots of graphic design material for art and cultural institutions, mainly. And this kind of poetry cards that Proto mentioned, that small cards, and then they were written poems, and Shkret will just go in the street and distribute them in street actions. Here are some images. So this was more or less, let's say, 90s with the heavily printed works. And from 2000 to 2010, this is the kind of period where the war ended, but it left behind a social isolation and rising nationalism. And it was at that stage that Shkret decided to embrace collectivity as a stance. And then they would start forming different groups, so choirs and embroidery groups, and just go in the streets and practice. For example, here there are some two choir performances in the street, and one of these places of the migrant camps, or like where orphan children live. And maybe also good to add that some of this, like this choir, for example, Volka Shkret, lasted 8 years, and then it also created other choirs. So it is this kind of sustainable friendship that also develops over time. And here are also some examples from the embroidery groups. And from 2010, I think there was a slightly pedagogic approach, and also then you start working with workshops, and mainly workshops of writing poetry, or again choir, or also animation, like paper puppet poetry, right? Like writing small lines of poetry and then making paper puppets, and then transforming these to video animations, mainly with children. This was more or less this 10 years, but Shkret still works with the elderly, again writing these poems too. Or this kind of like small booklets, like these ones, that for example, in every locality, every region, Shkret would work with a group on one certain story, and at the end of the workshop, there will be this kind of pocket books, booklets, and then Shkret would always then distribute this for free or you as a gift. Proto was kind of the more literal, and I think Jole was the more visual person, so here are some also visuals from Jole combined with Proto's poems. In the book also we included them. And the last chapter is Critical Framework, and here I commissioned three different essays, because of course I had this outsider perspective, and for me it was also important to bring the local perspective to the book. So we invited Branislav Dimitrijevic, a Belgrade-based art historian, and he also discussed the importance of Shkret in 90s and shaping this kind of, let's say, avant-garde scene in Belgrade. And his essay title was Shkret in the 90s, the politics of small gestures in the time of war and privatization. Second essay was from Zdenka Badovinac, as already mentioned, and she discussed Shkret's perspective, artistic practice from a wider perspective, and creates parallelities with commonality. And the last essay was from Milica, her last name?
Pekic.
Pekic. That she did a great kind of ethnographic work. It was for me really important to bring the voice of individuals and groups Shkret worked with in these occasions. Of course, there were lots of language barriers for me, and Melissa did an amazing thing, and she talked to, I think, 62 people that you worked with so far from different generations, and kind of created this beautiful article about their experiences and what kind of this collective work means for them. And at the end of the book, we have a vision glossary. Here, I tried to create some kind of notions and select some projects and works of Shikai and kind of gather under these notions. Because for me, working as an editor on the book, the biggest challenge was to make it, this like decision-making process was the most difficult, because in this 43 years of artistic practice, it was very clear that we can't, and also we don't want to put all the work in the book. So I tried to also focus on projects that have still certain relevance today. And also, of course, we discussed what was very important and maybe radical back then. So we choose that projects. But here in this visual glossary format, just as maybe little traces, let's say, we included so many visuals from each project and just add some tiny notes. So if you're curious, then you could just go and find about them more in detail. So yeah, self-distribution, subversion is one of them, or city as a playground. Yeah, important that the Shikai mainly worked outside of art institutions and in the city. So it was also very important for them to, by that way, reach a, reach a wider audience using city as a playground. And at the end of the book, we have a little interview with Merve Ünsal. So Merve did the copy editing of the book, but also we had lots of editorial discussion. Meanwhile, she was very helpful, and she suggested to make this really small interview between us to go through our decision-making process, which you can also read at the end. Maybe that's my side. Maybe you want to add something on design, so I can just go back to the beginning.
Yeah. So yeah, you already told the whole editorial structure of the book. So I don't have to add that much on that side. I think I can quickly tell how we met. So that was in Geneva at the art school over there. Seda was enrolled in a visual arts master's, and I was enrolled in a design master's, and we were roommates back then. So we worked already together in the early 2010s on some small projects, but mainly student projects. So nothing too serious and too ambitious back then. And so we kept in touch. We were friends, and Seda contacted me for this project once you were because you started the whole graphic design process with other designers. And then Seda asked me one day, like, "Hey, Rob, can you have a look at what we're doing? I really want to have your feedback on this." And I said, "Yeah, sure, send it over. I'm very happy to have a look." And so I think I made some quick comments. We had a talk about it. And then I already had the feeling that you weren't happy at that point, and that it wasn't going the right direction. But I didn't want to insist on anything or whatsoever. So then maybe a couple of months, half a year later, you came back and said, "Okay, Rob, I really need your help on this." And then I decided, or we decided, that we would do the book together from there on. We took in consideration what the other graphic designers did, but we basically started also from scratch. And then Seda, you really as you said, you've drawn out the whole structure of the book with the chapters, and also the fact that you wanted the visual the glossary in there. And I think my job was very much to make it a readable book, and to keep the structure like very understandable and also digestible in a way. You always wanted to add more, and then I said, "No, Seda, we can't." there was also a practical limitation. There's a practical limitation of a book in terms of text and images. We had cost limits. There were all these practical things to consider. Yeah. But it was such a huge chance and occasion to work on SCART's archive, and also with you, knowing that we trust each other and that we knew each other. I think there was this mutual trust that was very much necessary to make this book. Also because it was COVID, so a lot of Skype meetings and then sending back and forth PDFs, but only digital, no physical dummies or whatsoever. And I think I tried to set out the huge, rich archive of SCART and the dynamic in the interviews, especially because if you read the text, it was just sometimes I have to admit that if I need to lay out a book, I don't read all the text. I read maybe one or two chapters and then I say, okay, I have the notion of what the thing is about. But I think this time I really went through the whole interview and it was such a pleasure and fun to read. Also like to almost be there, like be like a voyeur in this discussion you had. And then that's also a reason why I maybe that's the only design detail I wanted to explain, is that Seda's text and each time that Seda intervenes in the interviews, she's a bit bigger, like the text and the text size is a little bit bigger. And I think that's because you really you shaped these interviews and you gave it their rhythm. And I think you're also very, your loud voice for me needed to be also visually translated. So that's maybe one design decision I wanted to highlight. Otherwise, it was just getting all the images in there and then also the visual glossary, making it something very fluid, very, very dynamic. If you switch the page, like go through the pages, it shouldn't feel like a chaptered sequence, actually. So that's, it was a huge pleasure to work on.
Good that you reminded, actually, yes, Rob is the third designer who worked on this book. Because with the archival material, it can get very complicated because the material is really shiny, right? I think it excites, honestly, every graphic designer. And that was also in my experience. But then the first two drafts, here, I think in Rob's design, everything looks really clean and really well structured and easy to read. But in the previous design, that was the problem. There was this kind of problem to structure things. Now, there's lots of material. There's this interviews, and then there's this like crazy long footnotes. For example, here you can see. I was very, at the end, happy that we managed to fit everything in this small size of the book.
Do you
want to add something, Proto Julia, or if
we just spoke before it started. Actually, we are proud what Rob did, because it's completely not the opposite, but different from how we will do design for our book. So most of witnesses of presentations, they've been quite shocked how book looks like, because for them it's almost kind of new lesson how design can be simple, structured, readable, but also also wild in the rhythm of presenting texts and images. So we are also proud that somehow we did this Mission Impossible, first started interviews with Seda and implementing other collaborators. And then, of course, from design side, to have Rob as a third voice, an unpredictable voice, which finally actually closed this messy material, let's say, in a book form. Because it, in the beginning, it really looked like unsolvable problem. But the problem is luckily solved, and we are really proud that it has this new language, which brought the new visibility to these messy materials and endless, and as also Seda said, this kind of always undone and unprepared archive. There are things in the boxes which are unopened from early 90s. In some storage places here and there, because if you are constantly in the process of rethinking and working and inventing and reinventing yourself, you never have time to look back. So actually, we never had time, neither reason to look back. There are always new steps, new initiations, new languages. We are jumping from media to media. In last period, we are working on film and on the graphic novels, new choirs, etc., etc. So it's endless process, and then in this endless process, suddenly Seda jumped in and said, "Okay, stop, try to look back." And we said, "Why? What for?" But luckily, actually, all these four persons you see here did something. So we are. In two words, we are proud. In three words, we are proud.
Yeah, and I think for me, I felt a huge confidence and trust also from your side, even without meeting each other, is that you didn't intervene in the graphic design process. And it's something I wanted to thank you for too, because it's not always the case, and I think many artists or collectors would have wanted maybe much more control or supervision over the project, and it was always almost as if you weren't there, and that it was only me and Seda working on this, and that there wasn't some approval from your side necessary for the work we were doing, which was for us, I think, a huge chance in a way.
I think because this is our first also first gathering of authors of the book, but also first meeting with you from here, from Istanbul. So we would like to hear your questions and maybe suggestions or comments or whatever. This is the, let's say, chance to start new dialogue with you. Even we don't know each other, but why not? It's time to exchange something. So please feel free and raise the hand, and I will give one mic, and then you can actually share it between you. Is it fine? Okay, so this mic goes there, and then it will stay there.
Thank you very much for the presentation and that you travel here, being with us. Amazing work. I'm just wondering, it seems like a parallel history writings that something happened in that period, but didn't kind of document it in a way that we can have it. Do you believe is there a potential of this era in this geography? There are much to discover, or like a lot of things just not visible because of different reasons?
I think actually each, let's say, geography and each culture has plenty of invisible things, but we are somehow ignorant towards our neighborhood. We are always watching towards far west or whatever. There are plenty of things which can be digged out from here or from Balkans or from here or there or Asia or Africa or wherever. So I think it's very important to be curious enough and to be really solidar for each culture and each resistance, because we are somehow constantly part of, let's say, political and cultural resistance. And also I see in this sphere here in Turkey that this scene is very present and it needs to be rediscovered and maybe re-encouraged and re-documented. So in three words, and answer is yes, yes, yes. There are so many undiscovered things and we need to actually hear each other, I think, more than we are doing in the moment.
I want to add something very shortly. For me, what was very interesting in the region, there is a really strong culture of self-organization and self-management in former Yugoslavia. And also this working in collectives. That was also something really new to me when I discovered there. And I think this is something really relevant today, especially like during pandemic period, it was, you know, again, this kind of notions were rediscovered, like in especially Central Europe. You know, we started talking about self-organization skills or like working in collectives, as also after Documenta, you know, this topic became very visible in Central Europe in now 2020s. But for me, then there is still a lot of examples of self-organization and artist collectives and how they manage to sustain themselves in lack of state foundations, you know, like in lack of well-developed, let's say, infrastructures. How they find their work, make and continue producing, there is still like a lot to learn.
I was going to ask, does the book contain any audiovisual poems as in the form of performance documentation, or will you plan to in the future maybe archive all those performance videos or in the form of DVDs or something else?
Do we have videos actually?
It's good actually suggestion. Most of the things we are not documenting. Because there are constantly so many things around and we actually don't care about documentation. Because it's ongoing thing. And in plenty of cases, documentation is forbidden. Because, for example, we are working with children in orphanage. It's forbidden to take any documentation. We are working with elderly people in gerontological center. It's forbidden to take any documentation. Etc., etc. So in plenty of cases, it's forbidden. In other cases, we don't care. So there are some in these boxes, there are some videotapes from 90s, for example, still un-digitalized. But who cares? I mean, it's endless process. And Joel and me, we are always asking ourselves, will somebody one day maybe be curious enough to knock, knock like Seda did and said, okay, can you please let us digitalize this? Because I don't have energy for that. I don't care. I'm curious for another steps. And I'm curious to meet you and to speak with you. And then who knows, choir thing tomorrow and then another and something, la, 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 la. So there are so many jumps around. And we are still alive and still curious. So answer for you in three words, sorry. Some material exists, even as I told you on videotapes or VHC or different, you know, who knows. And maybe we should start maybe documenting some things. And even as Jola said, maybe even reconstructing some things, why not? But there is no need. Nobody cares about that and nobody needs it. Once, maybe Joel has another opinion, but I will not let him say. I'm glad you told us this. And it's good, encouraging to to care about that level. Sorry, but actually this is a question for Rob about audiovisual, maybe additional material for the book.
Well, then it might not should be a book form, but something else, I think. Maybe you...
Yeah, the thing actually, this is really interesting because as Puta said, I was also really curious to see more material from this poetry and events. So there is this legal thing when you work with, for example, orphan children, as you already said, for example, you can't record. But then for me, it's also interesting. Okay, then we should find another form of documentation. But this applies to every... every performance, you know, in performance theory in general. So how can we document performance? Do we need it? I think yes, we need it, but the question is how? So in the book, we try to solve it like this, only with 2-3 maybe visuals we have from these events. So we combine this with poems, so written poems in these occasions and workshops. And plus, in this Milica's essay that I mentioned, she talks to these people who were part of these groups. And then we hear some parts of the story from their perspective. So you can maybe have the puzzle, you know, in different parts. You have the oral history, you have maybe one trace of a visual, and then you have poem. That's it. But I think for the future, yeah, it's an interesting question to think about how you can.
Just listen to what. It might happen that we are not that careful about documentation, is because from very beginning of our work, it's about collectivity. So we were working, two of us in collective, and when we started working in 1990, we wanted much more of us working together because we were students of architecture, and our idea was to work in a collective with 6-7 people, but other people were not interested to work in collective. So only two of us left. So all the 90s and since beginning till now, we're all the time trying to find people to collaborate with, to work together. That's most important. And the very important thing of our work, what I found, and it's most visible working with choir, is that we were much more focused then and now for having the proper good relationship with people we work with, and the work will be pleasurable for all. So to enjoy, all of us to enjoy working together rather than having a proper artistic result. And that might be the case why our documentation is not so proper, because for us, everything was done while working together. So if that was good, that was enough. So after that, having recorded like things was not really for us. That it might be the explanation why we were not why we didn't pay attention to the documentation process, which doesn't mean that we are clumsy while doing things, not at all. So when we do design, when we do the whatever, like writing poetry, drawing and things like this, we do our best, trying to make proper and, but on the first place is to enjoy working together. That's, and establish, if possible, long-term friendship. So for us, like choir thing, we started 2000 and it lasted 6 years under the name of Horkeskart. And our idea from very beginning was to, at one moment, let them lead it themselves, to introduce self-management in the choir. And we succeeded that on the end of 2006, and they still exist. After 23 years, they exist and they are quite popular and they're very politically engaged in Belgrade. We are all friends with them. We go to their concerts. They brought us poems and sing and so on. So that's a thing, establishing a proper friendship and good relationship. That I think it's perhaps the our goal of all these years.
Sorry, but just to add something, I agree with Jole, but not only that. There are so many levels on this process. For example, songs which children are singing. We are writing text together, and then composing together, and then rehearsing, and then you need to organize tour. For example, we had last week, we had one concert with the choir from orphanage, and it was messy time, and then new generations of kids came. And then we rehearsed just one song. And we said to the organizer in another city, oh, okay, we are choir, but we sing only one song. And they said, okay, why not? You can come and sing one song. So this was concert of one song. Why not? Kids were happy. We went there. They met another kids. And it was a song about new school, because you probably you heard what happened in Serbia. One 14 years old kid killed 9 kids in the school. So it was big mess. And actually, government closed the schools this Monday before school year is over, because it's really actually messy in the moment in the school system what is happening in Serbia. So this is a song about school system. And these kids bravely went to another city and sang song about school. But it's forbidden to document, but who cares? They did it. They sang song about school, and they've been brave enough to say, okay, we are choir which sings only one song. And for me, this is success. I mean, happiness. Okay, success, who cares about success? But happiness and kind of revelation. Okay, it can be also like this. Why not?
Sure, thank you.
For me, that's very interesting to listen to, because I'm an archivist and trying to figure out, kind of trying to undertake a research on independent art spaces and collectivities in Istanbul, and how would they create an archive, and what would be the thing that would impede it? Is it just money, the budget, or something else? So there was an answer that I couldn't imagine. So thank you for that. But I think I don't have a specific question, but what I was thinking was, the thing that you describe about documentation and the desire for it, but then the desire for the absence of it, maybe, or, you know, there are other priorities. I was thinking to myself, archiving could also be a kind of collectivity that could, you know,
can
contribute to that. And then to me, it sounded like a perfect occasion to think about different forms of archiving, you know? Like maybe we don't need a document, we don't need to document a process or the thing itself, but then we can find other ways, maybe narration, or I don't know, just something to think about. Mm-hmm. And
it sounds beautiful, or also any kind of participation, maybe to share some experiences together, and then from this sharing to actually steal some things and name them documents. Sorry. Mm-hmm.
Yes, absolutely. But and there can be, I don't know, a lot of things that would emerge from a discussion or collectivity itself. And then I was attracted to a point where, in the beginning of your, in the introduction, you said you were drawn to poetry because it was something that was completely unnecessary for a, and I was thinking to myself, is it unnecessary in terms of, you know, garbage, the surplus, the leftover, or something that is intrinsically? So, and you refer to the archive as, you know, in similar terms, like nobody needs it anyway, and
language is the power. Poetry is everywhere. But in the same time, if you go to libraries, poetry is hidden somewhere and it's rarely used. So most of the time, what we are actually dealing with is the forms which are a bit abandoned. So poetry is slightly abandoned form, and it has a power. So that's why we are using it. And in the same time, poetry is open enough to be applied everywhere, as a performance, as a graphic design, as a singing, et cetera, visual poetry, like we went today to see some of your traditional monuments. This calligraphy is really amazing. This is visual poetry. It really has a power. So in general, maybe unnecessary is not proper comment. Maybe it's too nihilistic. But in the same time, let's say poetry is hidden treasure. Okay, maybe it's better comment. Hidden treasure still free enough to be used by everyone and empowered by everyone.
Okay, maybe I not share his opinion because poetry is really hidden treasure. But what I see is it's like the poetry is perhaps have a little impact to the society, too much, little for my opinion. By my opinion, about the archives, why they are important? I think they are important to archiving the things, to preserve the history. So I did a one graphic novel about the testimony of one soldier of 91, friend of mine, who was drafted in the war. There was civil war in Yugoslavia, and he was drafted. And after 15 years, we met in London where he lives, and I said, we have to write your story, how you were drafted, because if we do not do this, it would not be written down and not archived. So if we don't have testimony of what happened, it opens a field for future generations to manipulate the history. And that's what we see in Serbia. I live in Slovenia. Everywhere, the people are manipulating the past. And that's why archives are very, very important. So if someone starts to telling you how the past was looking like, or lying to be more precise, you take the books, you take the testimony, and say, no, that was like this. It was written, it was recorded. And because of that, archives are very, very important to have the somewhere the memory of the past recorded and written.
I'll just add one thing, because this documentation and archive topic seems important for us in this discussion. So in line with, against Venka's way of thinking, I think it's also too much pressure and burden on artists' shoulder, you know, to produce the work and also to archive it and to document it. And I honestly think it's also mainly responsibility of institutions to take care of the archives. And there comes the problematic part. Also the conflict and difficulties when we were making this book. For practices like this, archival work, it requires lots of time and energy and budget. And even in Europe, no one is interested in supporting that kind of work, or let's say very, very few organizations, I'm based in Germany. When we were trying to make this book, I couldn't raise any certain amount of money in Germany or Serbia, forget about it. And I received funding from Kontaktstiftung, Erste Stiftung from Austria, because they have this, of course, political relationships now with the Balkans, and they invest on it. So they kind of invest such practices, from former Yugoslavia, and they also collect work. This Kontakt collection is now one of the biggest Yugoslavian artist collection in Austria. So you see all these complex relations, and also in relation to what you said, to digitalize the archive. I worked maybe for 2 years in this project for free because it was my passion and I did it, but I would also like to work continuing on it, digitalizing the archive and so on, but it needs to be sustainable at some point. You can't continue like this. Maybe any more? Come on.
About the documentation and connectivity and integration within the community. I was thinking about social media. I'm sorry, yeah. I was thinking about social media too, because I think that social media and the network itself can be a medium for documentation too, which does not provide, for example, a charge that are unaffordable. And it's also, I think, in a relation of protest art, it's also a very important source, because people are actually get connected not on the geographical territory or local events, but also more broader scope is targeted by social media and the internet network. In this case, I wanted to ask you about the initiatives like such as spreading the initiative in social media or in a digitalized network, proceeding with basically social media, maybe platforms like well-known Telegram channels or similar mediums.
Maybe this can be a question for Seda and Rob.
Maybe I can explain.
That was a great question. We are quite old and very, very late accepted social media. And still not, we have only Facebook by chance. And that was interesting that we were working, as you've seen already, with women embroideries. So that was the idea of 2000, working with the single mother from Serbia. They were refugees, and we wanted to start working with them in order to working together and exhibit their work, and by chance to sell it on the art market. We were never selling everything before that. So to sell their work and like selling their work to enable them getting additional salary, because they were very low salary they had at the time. Unfortunately, there were not many women who were willing to work, but anyway, there were few of them continuing working till now. And I said to Prota, I think maybe 5-6 years ago, like, if we want, because we are very bad managers, obviously. I said to him, if you want to spread it, their work around, make the Facebook page. And he made the Facebook page, and now we publish, put like every week or whenever they make new embroidery, he put on the Facebook, and now people are like it, and quite often they call us or write us to buy this piece of embroidery that's a handmade comment of everyday active politics and things like that. So this is the only way we use the social media. Otherwise, we never put on the Facebook anything about our activity. I still find it like a bit of shameless to write on the Facebook, like, look at, I have a presentation in Salt, go on or something. I would never do that. But for this woman and non-practical woman, I think it's very useful. And the power of social media is enormous. That's for sure. So that's, I guess that's a platform of the future, but we need time to adopt it in a way.
But also you did something good. Some of these poems that you did with elderly during COVID times, Shikar did a kind of workshop event with writing poetry through SMS with them, with the elderly in their isolated homes. And then they are now transformed into little animations and uploaded to YouTube. I was also very impressed, I must say, by this. So some things, but you know, I think it's not a kind of permanent idea. You know, it works very well in the present, but I think need to maybe develop more sustainable.
I agree completely with you, but actually answer goes to this documentation. You have no time to digest what you did, because there is workshop after workshop, after workshop after workshop, jumping here and there in this and that group of people. So there is always what maybe Jolie didn't mention, there is always new need for direct communication and direct, let's say, action and reaction. So this kind of presentation, whatever, is extra step for which you sometimes don't have any energy. It is useful, it is of course very organizedly needed, but you have no energy for it, because tomorrow is another something and another something and another something. So everything we tried and we succeeded to actually continue is weekly we publish new embroidery, but by non-practical women, and we are also publishing poems by people from gerontological center, pensioners. So they are works, their works, which we actually put on some network, and this is everything we can spend as this extra energy step, but it is necessary. And as your colleague said about documentation, about visual poetry or poetry in general, not visual poetry, but poetry in general, this can be actually useful as a next step. But maybe Rob can add something.
I'll try. No, I think it has a huge potential, which is not yet explored. I think social media are not at all designed to archive properly. It has a way different code. You know, that Twitter or Instagram, you have a limited amount of text that you can put in with an image. And you also have to accept, in a way, as an artist, I think, or me as a designer, that your work gets pulled out of context and out of proportion, that things are traveling differently. I think social media can be a huge support of archiving practices, also to promote them. But I'm not sure, or maybe there's still to be discovered how they can really maintain and contain the archive in itself. But I have colleague designers doing archiving, having Instagram accounts being an archive. But then it's visually beautiful, and then contextually sometimes quite problematic or not completely understandable. And also with students, I encounter many times that they come to me with inspiration or sources that they don't even know where they get them from, or that it's completely lost, like the trace in history, or where it comes from, who did the work, where in what context. It's, and I think for your practice that's highly important. So it's a very interesting question, and I think there's still a lot of things to be discovered and explored in that sense.
If there is no more comments or questions, maybe we can close by watching this really short, maybe 3 minutes of it we can watch, because it's one of the very few video documentations of your actions. So I think for like 4 or 5 years, right? Between 2000 to 2004, you were making these coupons.
2006, 96 to 2000.
Yes, for that within these 4 years, there's this lots of coupons that also Shikart was distributing in the streets, you know, going to the villages in every country. They would also print in the local language and distribute. So this is also one of the maybe very first documentations of it for me, Serbia.
Thank you.
Dobar dan. Hoćete malo jabuke? Ja sam član grupe Škart i pitaju me stalno šta je to Škart i zašto se zove Škart, ali ja još uvijek ne želim da odgovorim na to pitanje i ne znam.
Grupa Škart je osnovana na 50 godina u napuštenoj grafičkoj radionici Arhitektonskog fakulteta.
Da.
Mogu da kažem ukratko svašta smo radili i sad posljednja stvar koju radimo je projekat Pomoćni bonovi za opstanak.
Pomoću njih želimo ljudima da pružimo šansu da komuniciraju na neki nov način i da im na određen način ukažemo na situaciju u kojoj su oni potpuno izbrisali svoje lične živote, potisnuli neke svoje želje i strahove. Jednostavno se povukli u životnu neutralnost.
Gde da te stavimo, Kato?
Thank you for coming and hope we will continue collaborating with you. Why not?